Kiyoshi realized she needed to take out this guy.
We heard about that one from the Avatar herself.
It was absolutely unbelievable.
We're going to recap Avatar Kiyoshi's entire timeline, since we're obviously our biggest fans.
Go back. Return to the beginning.
Kiyoshi was an earthbender born after Avatar Guruk, and from the very start, she was dealt the worst deck of cards possible.
She was abandoned by her criminal parents when she was just a young child. She lived like a scavenger in this impoverished village called Yokoya Port.
Avatar Kiyoshi was born here 400 years ago.
Not to mention, she was this awkward, tall, clumsy girl who everyone just gawked at.
At this time, the world was in rough shape, and a lot of people blamed the late Avatar Kuruk. The Earth Kingdom had been targeted by these anti-government extremists called the Yellownecks. Nations were going hungry due to poor crops, and no one could figure out who the next Avatar was. Just that it was an earthbender.
The hunt for the next Avatar was being championed by two of Avatar Kuruk's old pals. There was Kelsang, this wise old air nomad. We love him.
Then there was Zhang Zhu, an earthbending master, who was a very wealthy diplomat. Not officially a public official, but clearly the guy pulling all the strings.
Still though, neither the Earth Sages or Kuruk's old friends could find the next Avatar. So Kelsang and Jianju resorted to using the Air Nomad method. You know the one.
Those were some of my favorite toys when I was little.
You chose them from among thousands of toys, Aang. The toys you picked were the four Avatar relics. These items belong to Avatar's past, your own past lives.
And they brought the setup to Yokoya Port. There, Kelsang met a young girl on the street, Kiyoshi. He invited her in to take the test.
Kiyoshi chose a little clay turtle, which did indeed belong to a past Avatar. I think Aang even chose the same toy decades later. But before she could pick another toy, she ran off.
You'd be suspicious of people too if you lived on the streets.
Well, also, they assumed she was too old to be the Avatar. Kiyoshi was, again, large for her age.
These were her boots? Her feet must have been enormous.
The biggest of any Avatar.
Eventually, Kelsang and Jeonju met this other kid who played Paisho, the exact same way the Avatar Kuruk used to play. And they ended up naming this kid the new Avatar.
Presenting the false Avatar, Yoon.
You're the Avatar?
Yoon seemed like the classic golden boy. Smart, athletic, handsome. Jianju even built an entire mansion for him to train near Yokoya Port.
Kelsang lived there too as Yoon's would-be airbending master. But over time, Kelsang got to know that local orphan, Kiyoshi.
The air nomad sort of became like a father figure to Kiyoshi. Kelsang even got her a service job in the mansion.
That's how Kiyoshi became super friendly with Yoon. It's also how Kiyoshi met Rangi. She was the daughter of Avatar Kuruk's old friend and Yoon's firebending master, Heiran.
Rangi was sort of like this tough military brat. Strong character, strong muscles, very disciplined. She was basically Yoon's bodyguard.
So even with all these people under one roof, only Kelsang and Jianju had ever toyed with the idea that the Avatar might actually be Kiyoshi.
They say you're good at keeping secrets.
That is until one day, Avatar Yoon was supposed to be signing a peace treaty on an iceberg just outside the South Pole. But it ended up being a trap. Yoon, Kiyoshi, Jeonju, they were all under attack with zero earth to bend in sight.
Until Kiyoshi earthbended this massive pillar of rock from miles beneath the water's surface. It was absolutely unbelievable. Something only the Avatar could do.
There was a huge battle. The pirates were defeated. It was all eyes on Kiyoshi. Everyone was wondering how the heck she pulled all that off.
Jeonju was done playing around. He dragged Yoon and Kiyoshi to this strange, deserted mining settlement. It sounded very toxic. And deep in some cavern, Jeonju sat them down and then paralyzed them with some sort of poison incense.
This huge, green eyeball blinked open. It was a spirit named Father Glowworm that Jeonju wanted help from.
Tell us which one is the real Avatar, Jeonju asked.
And a slimy, green fungus tentacle reached out, tasted their blood, and was like, it's obviously Kiyoshi.
My old friend, the Avatar. It's been a long time.
But apparently Father Glowworm hated the Avatar because of Kurok. So it tried to take Kyoshi, but Jeonju stopped it, and it took Yoon instead.
Maybe I should have chose someone else to dress up as.
Kyoshi went berserk. She began bellowing fire from her mouth like a dragon, which clearly meant the spirit was right. She's the Avatar.
But Jeonju was still savvy enough to restrain her, until Kelsong showed up.
Kelsong found out that Yoon was dead because of Jeonju. And when Kelsong threatened to tell the truth to the world, boom, Jeonju sent a rock straight through Kelsong's neck.
On that island, Kyoshi lost her friend, her entire understanding of life, and the closest thing she had to a father.
She actually went into the Avatar state and blacked out.
Just get out of here! Run!
The entire mining settlement was destroyed.
Kyoshi escaped on Kelsong's air bison. Jeonju survived, unfortunately, and the chase was on.
All Kyoshi wanted to do at this point was to kill Jeonju. That's really her goal for the bulk of this story. Though, there's also this mountain of guilt. If she had just managed to firebend before Yoon was taken, and Yoon and Kelsong might still be alive. Can you imagine having to deal with all that?
Kyoshi got back to Yokoya first, spilled the tea to Rangi, and the two ran off with just some provisions and old heirlooms from Kyoshi's parents.
Now, for some background info. When Kyoshi was abandoned, she had this big wooden box that she never opened, but she always hung on to. Then, when escaping, it broke open, revealing that iconic crown, fans, and makeup.
Kyoshi also had an old journal from her parents that she had been studying. Her and Rangi used it to track down her parents' old criminal gang, the Flying Opera Company.
Apparently, these outlaws used to go from town to town as onstage performers between heists. So dressing up is part of their ritual.
It's a warrior's uniform. You should be proud.
Separately from all that, Kyoshi always had trouble with small, delicate earthbending. She could only bend large objects in clunky motions. She could not earthbend a miniature replica city, for example. At least not until she began using these fans as extensions of herself.
These fans, they were her weapons, no?
Also refrain from touching the fans.
Eventually, Kyoshi and Rangi meet the Flying Opera Company. Kyoshi's parents are no longer around, but those outlaws decided to take these runaways in without even realizing Kyoshi's the Avatar. Well, except for one of them, this little old man, Lauga.
Lauga was apparently an infamous assassin who was hundreds of years old. He ended up tutoring Kyoshi on spirituality and assassination. Because Kyoshi was still hyper-fixated on killing Jeonju.
Lauga also taught Kyoshi how to live forever. Well, not outright, but he seemed to point her in the right direction.
Aging is just your body falling apart. With the right mental focus, you could place each little piece that's not where it should be back into the correct order.
The next stop on this lawless troop was a secret criminal village hidden among the Earth Kingdom. There, the Flying Opera Company got forced into helping a fellow outlaw out of prison.
Begrudgingly, they accepted the mission. Then as they prepared for this big rescue, Kyoshi and Rangi got closer than ever before.
One night, Kyoshi found Rangi sitting at the shore of a shallow lake. After a long talk, they admitted their fears and shared a kiss.
They ended up spending a whole night lying by that lake together. So romantic. Until one of their outlaw friends found them the next morning.
Kyoshi said, "This is exactly what it looks like. You got a problem?" And the outlaw friend shrugged it off.
Kyoshi may have felt massive self-doubt over being the Avatar, but she was totally unapologetic about being bisexual. It was amazing.
The night of the rescue was also the first time Kyoshi put on her parents' makeup. We learned that red, white, and black were the Flying Opera Company's signature colors.
White stood for treachery, a sinister nature, suspicion of others, and the willingness to visit evil deeds upon them.
Red stood for honor, loyalty, heroism, but that only applied to their chosen family, their brothers and their sisters among the Flying Opera Company.
dressed up like proper warriors, they ended up freeing the prisoner. Mission success, right?
Well, no, actually. The prisoner wound up being this incredibly awful, mass-murdering rebel leader of the Yellownecks, who everyone thought was disbanded by now.
Kiyoshi realized she needed to take out this guy, fast.
If you don't, darkness will engulf the world.
Kiyoshi goes up to bat against this horrible criminal one-on-one. But another surprise? He can lightning bend.
I'll show you lightning!
What? That's not even a thing at this point.
Despite that shocking twist, Kiyoshi ended up getting the upper hand. She used the avatar state to lift him up to the top of this massive tornado and then drop him.
Yellowneck crisis averted. Because of that, Kiyoshi, Rangi, and her flying opera friends took a quick moment to unwind. And that's when Zhangju struck. They got poisoned and Zhangju kidnapped Rangi.
Maybe I should have chosen someone else to dress up like too.
Kiyoshi put on her makeup, her headdress, and fans. People stared at her as she went to confront Zhangju, but she didn't care. This is who she is now.
The silk thread symbolizes a brave blood that flows through our veins. The gold insignia represents the honor of the warrior's heart.
The big showdown. Kiyoshi met Zhangju at a tea shop. He wanted her to act like his pupil. He wanted her to be what Yun was supposed to be.
And in that standoff, he threatened to bring down the entire building and all of the innocent people inside. He was going to sacrifice all those tea shop customers as a way of forcing his fantasy on Kiyoshi.
She was stuck there, trying to counteract his destructive earthbending and keep that building standing.
They're both frozen, pushing and pulling in opposite directions, when suddenly, Yun walks in.
Ah! Yun was alive? How's that for a reveal?
Only he seemed different, hollow inside.
Yun walked up to Zhangju, pulled out a rock, then bent it from the front side of Zhangju's chest to the back. It went straight through, and Zhangju died right there.
Yun got away because Kiyoshi was still trying to keep that whole building from collapsing. And once again, her understanding of the world got thrown out the window.
Insane, right? Just wait until you hear what happens in Shadow of Kiyoshi.
She set up camp with the Air Nomads. They accept her as the Avatar. She even got a little personal assistant, this Air Nomad Jinpa, who's very clearly in the Order of the White Lotus.
At one point though, Avatar Karuk appeared to Kiyoshi in a vision, pleading for help. But Kiyoshi couldn't make out the specifics. So she began to work on her spiritual connection.
Clearly, you need more training to grasp the depths of your spiritual connection.
And she was also hunting for Yun, desperate for answers.
Fast forward to this party in the Fire Nation. There were massive tensions over the Fire Nation throne, drama that got fueled by Kiyoshi's political inexperience.
Then that drama got cranked up when Yun crashed the party. He was on a mission to kill everyone who lied to him about being the Avatar. And he ended up killing Liu Beifong, a super wealthy, super powerful relative to the one and only Toph Beifong.
What?
Yun escaped, but it was clear that Heidan was his next target. So Heidan, Rangi, and Kiyoshi left the Fire Nation capital to find a sage. Kiyoshi was still urgently trying to build up her spiritual connection in hopes that Karuk could provide some answers.
In the process, the political tension exploded. Riots broke out, Heidan almost got murdered by Yun, and Kiyoshi and Rangi got into a huge fight.
And that is when Kiyoshi began to learn that some wars needed to be fought alone. So she left her girlfriend behind.
And this way, no one else has to get hurt.
Soon after, Kiyoshi finally met with Karuk, who spilled all the tea. Apparently, while everyone thought Karuk was some carefree transient, he was actually stopping the world from destruction by fighting all these evil spirits alone. Because every time he fought them, they were infecting his soul like a virus.
Karuk didn't tell anyone because he didn't want anyone else to suffer. He knew friends like Kelsang and Heidan would help him, but Karuk couldn't let their souls deteriorate like his. He sacrificed his health and his reputation. It was quite a tragic tale.
Oh, and guess what spirit Karuk was constantly fighting? Father Glowworm.
Father Glowworm was boring holes in between the real world and the spirit world, holes that evil spirits use to try and attack humanity.
When Kuruk finally had it out with Father Glowworm, the spirit survived, though their repeated confrontations meant that Father Glowworm and the Avatar had become irreversibly connected.
At some point too, we found out how Yun came back from the spirit world. After all that anguish over being lied to, Yun convinced Father Glowworm to join forces, but Yun turned the tables when he ate Father Glowworm, giving himself the power to tunnel between worlds.
You have quite an appetite.
By now, Kyoshi realized she had a soul connection with Father Glowworm, and consequently, Yun. So she could pinpoint where in the world Yun was at any given time. It was time to bring the war to him.
You want to fight the Avatar? Then let's finish this.
The final confrontation happened at the old mansion in Yokoya Port. Total insanity. We assumed it was a one-on-one, Kyoshi versus Yun, until Rangi and the Flying Opera Company showed up to help.
Still, Yun's strength couldn't be overstated. The battle boiled down to Kyoshi, Rangi, and Yun. There was even this awesome moment where Kyoshi and Rangi regrouped and realized they were missing their war paint. So with their faces covered in dust, they wiped their blood around their eyes to complete the look.
But moments after, Yun sent a spike through Rangi's chest. Kyoshi had to sit there and hold her dying girlfriend in her arms.
Yun walked over to Kyoshi, warning that this would keep happening if Kyoshi kept trying to stop him.
Kyoshi began apologizing for everything that had happened, and Yun was eating it up. This is what he had been waiting for. He knelt down next to Kyoshi, wanting to absorb every painful word she said. Yun was like, "Tell me what else you're sorry for."
Then Kyoshi put her palm to Yun's chest in a gesture of comfort and said,
"I'm sorry for saying you had to live with your pain, because you won't."
Then this burst of frost blew out from Yun's back, like angel wings. Poof. Then he fell to the ground, dead.
Kyoshi had flash frozen Yun from the inside out. And immediately, Kyoshi brought that other hand to Rangi to begin healing her, waterbender style.
For a moment too, the only water Kyoshi had to heal her girlfriend with was her tears. Tears that were still glowing from the Avatar state.
Rangi lived, as did the remaining members of the Flying Opera Company.
And at the end, she had a vision where she met Yang Chen, the air nomad avatar who had been so highly regarded by the public.
The people of this generation literally prayed to Yang Chen.
Keep in mind too, by this point, the world still saw Kuruk as an absolute failure. Only Kyoshi knew the truth about his sacrifice.
But Yang Chen revealed that Kuruk faced such challenging spirits because she was the one who neglected her spiritual obligations. It was Yang Chen's fault, even though she was the poster woman for perfect avatar.
Basically, every avatar had issues that were a direct result of a past avatar's actions.
There would never be resolutions free from consequence, and that lesson helped empower Kyoshi moving forward.
So, what do we know beyond these two stories? Well, Kyoshi eventually mastered the avatar state, becoming feared and effective while restoring order in the world.
She didn't hide her bisexuality, and tried to spread tolerance for non-heterosexual people, even amongst the Earth Kingdom who had been the slowest to accept change.
Kyoshi also stood up against men causing trouble for women. Eventually, she decided to train women in defensive combat so that they could protect themselves.
You mean the Kyoshi warriors?
That's right.
Of course, there was the whole Chin the Conqueror debacle.
Yeah, we heard about that one from the Avatar herself.
Chin the Conqueror threatened to throw the world out of balance. I stopped him, and the world entered a great era of peace.
But you didn't really kill Chin. Technically, he fell to his own doom because he was too stubborn to get out of the way.
Personally, I don't really see the difference.
We also found out what happened after Kyoshi defeated Chin the Conqueror.
In Escape from the Spirit World, we learn all about the birth of the Dai Li.
There was a huge peasant uprising. The peasants felt the Earth King's role was outdated, and he didn't represent their interests. So they stormed the upper rank.
The Earth King demanded Kyoshi squash those unruly peasants. She refused and clapped back at his guards.
She said, "Everyone in this kingdom must have a voice if balance is to prevail over tyranny," which honestly is good advice no matter what era.
She demanded that the king listen to the peasants, and then she'll protect their interests. The king agreed.
So Kiyoshi goes and trains an elite force of earthbenders. They were silent and precise, feared by all. They became the Dai Li.
And sometime after she died at the age of 230, the Dai Li become corrupt, overthrowing the Earth King entirely during the Hundred Year War.
But Avatar Kiyoshi did continue to show up in Avatar Aang and Avatar Korra's lives. Like when Kiyoshi provided some sound advice on how to end the Hundred Year War.
I offer you this wisdom, Aang. Only justice will bring peace.
I knew I shouldn't have asked Kiyoshi.
Overall, I think Kiyoshi's my favorite avatar because she's so proudly bisexual. It's one thing to feel different than everyone else, but that can mean a lot of things, like being a suspiciously large woman, or, you know, being the avatar. Being gay, bisexual, lesbian, or queer, or transgender, that's tough because you have to accept it in yourself first if you're ever to be happy. And for some, it's too easy to hide.
I think Kiyoshi's my favorite because of her look. There's people who see themselves one way, but desire to be something else. And with Kiyoshi, she puts on that mask, the makeup, the outfit, and that's what pushes her to be powerful. Confidence is a tricky thing, and sometimes playing dress up makes you the person you dream of becoming. And I think it helped me find my true voice and power that I had within me the entire time.
Watching Avatar impacted me growing up because I saw Asian representation on television. Seeing Asians represented in a positive way lets me know that I can be powerful as well in this world.
What's your favorite thing about Avatar Kiyoshi?
What stood out as the most awesome or inspiring moment to you?
Comment below, and don't forget to like, share, subscribe.
And remember, keep watching for all things Avatar.
But if I could have met any Avatar, I'd have to pick Kiyoshi. Taking down a shark squid with one hand? Now that's a lady I'd like to get to know.